The question of Israel-Palestine can be described as deadlock, a nightmare, depending on obviously the point of view. But it is one of the most monstrous creature of imperialism in reality. The situation that Palestinian people are living in Palestine is not only decided in Palestine, has been decided outside of Palestine by the imperialist powers. And that's the first point, obviously, that we want to raise. And the destiny of Palestine is also being decided outside of Palestine. The Israeli people, the Jewish people, the majority of society in Israel, and the Palestinians living in Israel or living in the Palestinian Authority or outside as exiled in the refugee camps that were formed more than 70 years ago after the declaration of independence of Israel, or basically the birth of Israel. All these people are just small change in the power struggle between the big imperialist powers, and a lot of what has been happening in Israel-Palestine can be explained mainly by highlighting the contrasting interests and conflicts between different imperialist powers. The Palestinian question is the outcome of what imperialism and capitalism envisaged as the solution of the Jewish question, and the solution to the Jewish question by establishing a homeland for Jews in Palestine has turned into a nightmare both for the Palestinian and the Jews. Today they're living this type of this nightmare. And the situation is completely deadlocked with no possible solution in sight on the basis of capitalism. In 1940, the great revolutionary and Marxist Leon Trotsky, just before being killed by a Stalinist agent in July 1940, he issued a warning for the Jewish people. And he said that the attempt to solve the Jewish question through the migration of Jews to Palestine can now be seen for what it is, a tragic mockery of the Jewish people. The future development of military events may well transform Palestine into a bloody trap for several hundred thousand Jews. He was developing this analysis of the situation in Israel-Palestine by a Marxist standpoint, because the emancipation or the solution of the national problem, which is goes beyond the national problem, obviously, of the Jewish question, could not be achieved just by means of establishing a Jewish state favoring immigration and so on, as it was envisaged by the imperialist powers who were in charge and were controlling and running the show in Palestine. The origins of the conflict go back quite a long time, obviously. Already in 1916, on the eve of the collapse of the Ottoman Empire after the First World War, but in 1916, just before that happened, there were already secret dealings between the two major imperialist powers who had important interests in the future setup and reparting between them the spoils of the Ottoman Empire. These two powers were France and Britain. And the secret agreement between these two powers designed the partition and the modern composition and modern state articulation of the whole area in the Middle East. For example, the British got Palestine as a mandate after the collapse of the Ottoman Empire. The French had more influence in Lebanon, in other areas, And they basically decided, upon the heads of millions of people who were completely oblivious of this type of negotiation going on, for the destinies of the whole portion of the world. They did so for their to pursue their own interests as world powers, and obviously also to seize the assets and the wealth of that region. Not last, obviously, oil, which at the time wasn't as predominant as today in the equilibrium of world capitalism, but was becoming more and more important. So obviously, oil played an important role. As a result of this type of agreements and the establishment of new states after the First World War in the whole area, we see the setup of regimes of different types in the Middle East. And most of these regimes, all of them, in fact, were proxy regimes which were supported and shaped and trained and developed by the imperialist intervention in the area. Even the monarchies, for example, the Jordan monarchy or the Iraqi monarchy or the Egyptian monarchy, which was established after the collapse, after the First World War, these were, or Saudi Arabia, these were entirely appointed and propped up by British imperialism. The Hashemite monarchy, for example, didn't have any particular tradition in Iraq, but was set up as a decision of Britain. So, and then after, immediately after that, in order to gain the support the Arabs and the Jews as well, during the First World War, there was the famous Balfour Declaration. Basically, British imperialism promised Palestine both to the Arabs and the Jews almost at the same time in a very cynical way. With the Balfour Declaration, for example, Britain promises the establishment of a national home for Jews in Palestine. So basically supporting the idea of a national home being created by supporting the immigration into Palestine of hundreds of thousands of Jews escaping from Europe, from different parts of the world. That was basically the promise to accomplish what was presented as the dream of a Zionist homeland for Jews. The Zionist movement developed in the late 19th century. But quite tellingly, even at the origins of the Zionist movement, there was no such thing as for example, the idea of creating a homeland in Palestine, the promised land, the Jewish population in Palestine was extremely small at the time, and the Zionists were looking for any place, basically, in the world where a national home for the Jews could be settled. They even considered Argentina or some other possible place where to establish their project. With the Balfour Declaration, Britain gets behind the Zionist the Zionist project and designs Palestine as the future homeland for a process of Jewish immigration. Obviously, Palestine was not a deserted land. It was inhabited by people living there for thousands of years and centuries. And the existing population of Palestine was never considered as anything important in all this, both by the Zionist strategists and by the imperialist powers. A process of Jewish immigration started in the 1900s. Was already in place, but then became more and more prominent during the 1920s, the 1930s, up to the point where we have the first clashes, the first strong frictions between the pre-existing Arab population of Palestine and the Jewish immigrants settling in Palestine. The Jewish Authority, which was settled in order, was established in order to coordinate all this colonization process, had in their aims as a statutory aim that of acquiring Arab land and clearing it up for colonization, and then connecting all these settlements into an administrative unit. They developed, for example, the embryo of a militia, armed forces for the Jewish Authority, and so on. And so to the run-up of to the declaration of Israel, I don't have time to deal with all the historical process. What we had in Palestine was a rising and more organized Jewish settlement, which was not the majority of the population, but was growing and was becoming more and more powerful, to the point that the British imperialists got scared of the rising influence of the Jewish Authority in Palestine. Palestine was under the mandate of Britain up until 1947, and the British Authority started to climb down on Jewish immigration, putting limitations to the acquisition of land in order to avoid an open conflict into developing into Palestine. That obviously wasn't able to stop the process, which was already had already gained momentum. And obviously, with the war in Europe, the persecution of the Jews, the whole process of trying to find an outlet and a safe haven for the Jews became impossible to could not be contained anymore. There is a part of the process leading to the declaration of Israel, which is probably not very well known, where, for example, the military units and military groups of the Jewish settlers around the Haganah, which was the Jewish militia, and around other military formations like the Sternband and the Zwei Leumi, basically acted as terrorist groups in Palestine against the British authorities, against the Arab majority, attacking the institutions of the government. There were targeted killings of United, what would then become the United Nations mediators. There were even bombs planted in the very offices of the Palestine Mandate structures, the King David Hotel, where dozens of people were killed. There was a combined effort in the run-up to 1947 and 1948, which is the moment when all these military operations on part of the Jewish settlers culminated. The strategy of the Zionists was that of pushing out the Arab population. In 1947, the British authorities renounced the mandate, and basically the whole situation started to collapse. That was seen and was seized as an opportunity by the Zionist leaders, who started a campaign of terror against the Arab population. There were several massacres. We're not talking about hundreds of thousands of people being killed, but enough in order to create the terror in the Arab population and pushing them out of the territory that the Zionists wanted to consolidate as the future state of Israel. The process started it started already in 1947, but in the spring of 1948 became a massive campaign of coordinated actions between Haganah and the different terrorist groups supporting the declaration of a state of Israel. And the outcome of that process was a landmark in defining what we are talking about today as the Israel-Palestine question. So the establishment of Israel was 71 years ago now, between the 14th and 15th of May of 1948. and was achieved on the back of a wave of terror, which ended in the exile for hundreds of thousands of Palestinian people who had to abandon their villages and homes and were pushed out of what would become in the future state of Israel, the boundaries after 1948. We're talking about 700,000 to 800,000-900,000. It's not clear how many people were pushed out. And most of these refugees found, settled in refugee camps, which are still in place today. You can go around the Middle East in Lebanon, or Gaza itself was a massive 70%, by the way, 70% of the Gaza population today is made up of refugees or people or offspring of refugees of the 1948 war of independence, if you want, or Nakba, as the Arab described the disaster, the big defeat. So, what we have today is has been the establishment of a country, Israel, which was has converted into a bloody trap both for the Palestinians and the Jewish the Jews in Palestine. Which is a powerful machine perfected over many years, pursuing the same policies which we see at play today. This has been consistently done since the formation of Israel up until now, in a situation where the national question and the contraposition between Arabs and Jews is the founding element of Israel today. And you cannot understand the enormous contradictions that we can see, for example, in the political landscape in Israel in the latest elections, with all sorts of extremely reactionary parties getting quite an echo in the elections, the radicalization of the position of Netanyahu and the Israeli government over the past few years is just a reflection of that. So all these the foundations of Israel have been laid on the oppression of the Palestinian people, and that is kind of has become now enshrined even in the constitution of Israel. Just last year, we saw the approval of the new constitution, the new law state law, which is basically establishing for the first time in a clear black and white written paper the institutional oppression of the Palestinian minority within the confines of Israel. Obviously, the Israeli constitution doesn't apply to the Palestinians living outside of Israel. But there is a minority of Palestinians in Israel, about 20% of the population, or 1.6, 0.7 million people, who are now officially second-class citizens. What we have analyzed as Marxists last year when this law was approved is that it's just a recognition of a de facto situation which has always been there. The Palestinians in Israel have always been second-class citizens. For example, they cannot, apart from the Druze, who are a specific minority of the Palestinian population, for example, Palestinians cannot serve in the army. They do have Israeli citizenship according to where they live, but there are many different layers or many different Palestinians who have not a clear access on citizenship rights. The Palestinian parties, for example, were banned from, some of them were banned from the last elections. They couldn't even run their candidates. So there is, and there are a number, an enormous number of these discriminatory laws on the practical things. For example, the access, the possibility of buying land or buying houses or having houses which have been built but are deemed to be illegal because they're not recognized officially, to have them recognized officially as property. The property rights, for example, of the Palestinians are continuously eroded, challenged on a day-by-day squeezing out of the Palestinian population. This goes on within Israel itself, but it is also applied as a policy towards the areas, the parts of Palestine which are not officially under the control of Israel, but in reality they're just occupied territories. There was basically what has been described for many years since 1948 as the peace process in Palestine is only a fiction, has never really it's never been in reality a genuine peace process. It's just a negotiated settlement of the de facto situation which has been created on the ground by the Israeli ruling class and imperialism. So the successive agreements which have been reached by Israel and the Palestinian Liberation Organization, which became at some point the representatives, recognized representatives of the Palestinian people within Israel and in the refugee camps. All these treaties and accords and endless discussions have only ended up in a progressive marginalization of the Palestinian population, which are have been expropriated of every right they had, and have been expropriated even of their dignity. In 1993, there was a breakthrough, was presented as the ultimate peace plan, and it was the Oslo and Madrid Accords, which gave birth to what we know now as the Palestinian Authority. This idea that you could settle the situation and create an equilibrium and defend both the rights of the Jewish Israeli citizens and the Palestinians, find a solution, a mediation to the conflict. Let's say that's how the majority of the mass media presented the discussions around the Oslo and Madrid Accord. But all these accords were always forced upon the Palestinians by imperialism, in particular by US imperialism, who are catering these talks. But all these settlements and accords are not worth even the paper they were written on. On the very day they were approved, a number of measures on the ground put in place by the Israeli ruling class have always challenged even the basis of what has been achieved in terms of negotiations and settlement before. The idea that you could build a two-state solution to the Israel-Palestine problem has shown, in fact, to be completely a complete reactionary utopia. In 1993, the Oslo Accords established the birth of the Palestinian Authority. The Palestinian Authority was supposed to become a semi-state representing the rights of the Palestinians in Palestine. A very reduced territorial base, Gaza and the West Bank. But now after how many years have passed? 1993, it's more than 25 years. After 25 years, we can see that this Palestinian Authority is not a viable state. It's not a viable entity of any sort. They are dependent on Israel on everything. Even the mobile phone network is run by Israel. Water is supplied by Israel. It's scattered with hundreds of thousands of Israeli settlers who have conquered or have established their presence inside the West Bank in particular and East Jerusalem, which is another occupied territory by Israel, or the Golan Heights, which is another occupied territory. It doesn't matter whether the international community, the United Nations community in inverted commas, obviously, recognize or not Israel's dominance over these territories, the matter of fact is that Israel controls everything. The access to all the resources, the livelihood of about 5.5 million of Palestinians living between Gaza and the West Bank is controlled at whim by the Israeli state. And every excuse is made, is seized to create the conditions for a living nightmare for these people. The access to education, to hospitals is blocked. A wall has been built in order to surround and protect and enclose the hundreds of thousands of Israeli settlers within the territories which were supposed to be the Palestinian Authority. And these walls and checkpoints and razor wires and a network of roads which only Israeli settlers can use, for example, they're not open for the Palestinians to use, have created a nightmare situation where communities have been cut off from their livelihood. For example, rural Palestinian communities been completely blocked from accessing their lands, which then have been englobated or seized by the settlers. The philosophy of the Israeli ruling class is epitomized in a tweet by Netanyahu. This was 1 year ago, and he was at the celebration to open a new center in the name of Shimon Peres, and he said that Peres aspired towards peace, but he knew that true peace can be achieved only if our hands strongly grasp defensive weaponry. In the Middle East and in many parts of the world, there is a simple truth, and this truth is that there is no place for the weak. The weak crumble, are slaughtered, and are erased from history, while the strong, for good or for ill, survive. The strong are respected, and alliances are made with the strong, and in the end, peace is made with the strong. So this is the point of view, it really shows the point of view of the Israeli ruling class. It's not just Netanyahu, but this has been the policy of the Israeli ruling class, and this policy has been backed in the main, although with frictions and differences on the tempo, on what could be allowed in this or that particular moment, but has been generally backed by all imperialist powers. And here we have to see there is no distinction between, for example, the United States, who are clearly backing and recently even openly backing even a more extreme solution from their point of view of the Palestinian question by totally with Trump totally backing and supporting in every step, in every future plan Netanyahu. Even running a joint election campaign in the recent Israeli elections that were held just 1 month ago, with an open support by Trump for Netanyahu. But in the past, there have been frictions, there have been differences, but in general, imperialism sees Israel as the most reliable, the most important point of support for imperialism in the Middle East. Israel has developed a modern economy, has developed the most powerful army in the region. This has been shaped up and developed over decades. Also is because of the poisonous effects of the national question in Israel-Palestine, at many junctions and many important moments in the history of Israel, for example, the ruling class has successfully managed to imbue into society the idea that Israel is under siege, is surrounded by enemies, and therefore any threat to Israel is used to mobilize important parts of the population in support of the reactionary role that Israel is playing in the area. But Israel is, in the end, a capitalist country like Britain. Well, not exactly like Britain, but still capitalist, the same, with a huge polarization within Israel, enormous problems facing the Israeli working class. And when I'm talking about the Israeli working class, I'm talking about the Jews and the Palestinians as well. There is, as I said, a minority of Palestinians living in Israel, about 20% of the population. And they represent an important part of the Israeli working class, along with Jewish workers as well. The huge polarization of wealth, inequality, the austerity policies carried out by the government are masked constantly with this frenzy of nationalistic discourse and racist activities carried out by the Israeli government and the institutions. And obviously, the continuous clash and the continuous conflict, which is inevitable given the conditions with the Palestinians in the occupied territories, in Gaza in particular recently, but also in the West Bank, is being used as a way of continuing and strengthening this impression by the Israeli workers that Israel is under threat. The Arab regimes surrounding Israel are extremely reactionary, so the vast majority of the Israeli workers, they don't see Jordan, which is an oppressive regime, or Saudi Arabia, which is an even more oppressive regime, or any of the other reactionary Arab regimes as a possible model or as a possible partner in a peaceful transition in the future. And I think they're quite right in having a being extremely wary of the Arab leaders. The Arab leadership, the Arab ruling classes have been using the Palestinian question in order to gain some credentials and gain popularity. We had several cases in the past, but basically, the League of Nations, of Arab regimes, was financing and supporting, to a certain degree, the Palestinian Liberation Organization for many years. But in order for the PLO to defend their own interests, not so much the interests of the Palestinian people, it was a very cynical support. We have the case of, for example, of the massacre of Black September in Jordan, where the Jordan monarchy unleashed the state repression against the Palestinian refugees and the PLO, killing, well, it's difficult to say, but maybe 5,000, 10,000 people in Black September 1970. So there is a history of the Arab reactionary ruling classes of using instrumentally the Palestinian question for their own interests. On the other hand, the Israeli ruling class and imperialism are using the history of Israel, the several wars they had to go through, wars of expansion, but also defensive wars, like the Yom Kippur War, for example, as a way of supporting and developing Israeli nationalism and to strengthen this idea that Israel is under siege and threatened. And obviously, I'll spend just a few minutes, the last minutes, on what is the situation now, and also what can be done, what perspectives arise from the situation in Israel-Palestine for the future development of a revolution in the area, a revolutionary process in the area. As I said, Israel is a capitalist country. Israel is affected by the global capitalist crisis, as all the other countries, and even more in a sense, because it's an economy based on exports, which have to find an outlet on the world market. It is a fragile economy. It is true that Israel is a powerful state with a powerful military in the region, but nevertheless, it's just a small state and cannot really win a military conflict or economic power or economic war with the rest of the world. They rely a lot on US subsidies, and the US subsidies are an important part of the military expenditure of Israel, numbering in the dozens of billions of dollars per year. I can't remember the figures, but it's a staggering figure. And the crisis in Israel is very because of the impact of the national question, the distortive impact of the national question, has found it very difficult to manifest itself over the past decades. But there are some indications of what can happen in the future. The first real important movement which I want to highlight was the Intifada. The Intifada developing from in 1987 in what were the occupied territories. Israel occupied these territories in 1967. And since then, West Bank and Gaza and East Jerusalem were under military administration by the Israeli state. A revolt developed in the occupied territories in December 1987. And this revolt shook the real, the very foundations of Israeli society, because a lot of business and industry was developed in the occupied territories. They were the idea of the Israeli ruling class was to include them at some point, but they were reluctant of allowing the Arabs in the occupied territories to reach a status of citizenship. Because that would create problems in terms of allowing them, for example, to vote. And the fear of being outnumbered by the Arabs, it's a constant fear of within Israel society. The demographic war at play with the Arabs is a day-to-day occurrence. There are even comedy shows which are based on this. For example, there was one comedian who, comedy shows which were highlighting the idea of the Israeli government issuing a ban on Jewish people to leave Israel, even for holidays, with counters at the airport saying, counting the number of Jews living in Israel and the number of Arabs living in Israel being equalized, and therefore, having to grant certain concessions to the Palestinians. It's just organized madness. But in terms of comedy, they're just exposing this obsession with the demographic question. We saw with the Intifada the emergence for the first time of a mass movement of the Palestinian people after many years, and that appealed to important sections of the oppressed layers within Israel. It was part of the working class responding to it. Even the shopkeepers in Jerusalem, even the Jewish ones, joined the Intifada at some point. There was the possibility of connecting that movement against the occupation with the movement of the oppressed layers within Israel. That was crushed by the repression against the Intifada and the turn taken by the movement along a conflict between the Arabs and the Jews. So in that way they managed to diffuse and neutralize the potential impact of the Intifada. There was another example more recently of the big impact, for example, of the Arab revolutions. In this book, we analyze the Arab revolutions in Egypt, Tunisia, and other important countries in 2011. This wave of revolutionary movements throughout Northern Africa had a huge impact on Israel. And we saw the development of a big movement within Israel on the question of housing, and even a joint movement for the recognition of civil rights of the Palestinian minority and so on. So it became a mass movement, which had lasted for a couple of months, against the government, against the corruption of the Israeli ruling class, which is one of the main questions that are arising from, for example, the latest elections, even the fragility of the Israeli ruling class in keeping hold and keeping control over the Israeli working class. And that's the reason why they're pushing a more nationalistic, more aggressive policies against the Palestinians in order to create stir up the conflict, which consolidates the two sides in the conflict. On one side, the Israeli government and the reactionary forces within Israel. On the other side, forces like Hamas, for example, in Gaza. Just a few words about Gaza, because last year we had the big movement in Gaza, which was a heroic movement of the youth in Gaza. Gaza is has been described by a United Nations rapporteur, human rights rapporteur, in the following way. This guy is called John Dugard, and he described Gaza as a sealed-off, imprisoned, and occupied territory. It's an open-air prison where about 1.8 million people live. Israel appears to have thrown away the key. So basically, Israel is has encircled Gaza, which is a very small territory, one of the most densely populated territories in the world, of about 40 kilometers per time times 12, where about 2 million people live in unbelievably harsh conditions. And the conflict in Gaza is not really a conflict. It's snipers and military personnel of the IDF, the Israeli Defense Force, shooting on unarmed people on the other side of a border which shouldn't even be there. It's not a proper border anyway. The idea of defending the fence by shooting people, well, brought to the attentions of millions or billions of people in the world the tragedy that is happening in Gaza. The defense minister of Israel at the time said that in Gaza there were no innocent people, and that therefore it was justified to use this excess of force and repression against peaceful demonstrators. There were flying kites across the border. That was the kind of this movement also expresses another thing, that you can have individual suicide, but that cannot be applied to entire peoples. The situation the Palestinian people is living in Gaza or in the West Bank in the nightmarish situation determined by the increasing settlements and walls and razor wires and barriers being built to prevent them from free movement and everything, carrying out a normal life of any sort, is pushing the Palestinian masses to the limit, and to the point where even going and demonstrating with the clear knowledge that you're going to be shot or killed or maimed. There were 300 people killed over the past year along the fence of the border with Gaza. But that's just the tip of the iceberg, because there are 6,000 or even more who have been seriously injured and by bullets, which are designed to destroy the target they are hitting, because these are this type of bullets that expand when they hit the body. So maimed legs, arms, or very serious injuries. In a situation where Gaza is collapsing, the health system in Gaza is collapsing, the influx of drugs and medicines or even blood is blocked by Israel at the borders. So it's a complete hopeless situation from all points of view. Yet there are thousands and tens of thousands of people who are willing to take up the flag and develop the struggle. At some point, and this point might not be very far in the future, this type of resilience and struggles developing from the Palestinian people in the occupied territories, which are effectively occupied by Israel, will connect and is connecting with the Arab population, the Palestinian population within Israel, and it will also inspire at some point the struggles of the Israeli youth and working class against the system that has created this nightmare. Obviously, in order to achieve that, we need to give a perspective. How is possible to achieve a solution of this nightmare in Israel-Palestine? The only way to achieve that is by overthrowing the capitalist system that has created this nightmare. Not just, obviously, not just in Israel and Palestine. By the way, even in Palestine, there is a bourgeoisie, and this bourgeoisie is taking advantage and profiting from this situation. They are the kind of sparring partners of the Israeli ruling class, the minor. They get just the crumbles of the profits. But nevertheless, they are flourishing. They've been becoming richer and richer. There were scandals, for example, of even people high up in the hierarchy of the Palestinian Authority collaborating with Israel in business, like, for example, even building the wall, there were Palestinian companies collaborating with Israel in building the wall, which was meant to basically graphically expose the oppression of the Palestinian people. They are benefiting from the crumbles of the profits of imperialism. A lot of people don't know, for example, that the Palestinian Authority as a concept was established in 1993 with the aim of policing the Palestinian people. So since then, the Palestinian police in the Palestinian Authority is running jointly with Israel. They exchange information, they target individuals who are considered dangerous by Israel, they detain these individuals in Palestinian jails. There is an active collaboration on part of the Palestinian Authority and part of the Palestinian bourgeoisie in oppressing their own people. So the only way of breaking this is by establishing links and a joint movement against all the forms of oppression in Palestine and in Israel, a joint movement of the working class, which can only come about as a consequence of the progressive impact of the capitalist crisis on the livelihoods of both the Palestinians and the Jewish workers. But that also will be helped by the process of international radicalization and revolutions, which is swiping the globe and is hitting country after another, where oppressive regimes are challenged and threatened and overthrown by mass movements, like in Sudan, like in Algeria. These movements are talking not just to the Palestinian masses, but also to the Jewish workers in Israel. It is the task of the Marxists to find a common path between the struggle of the Palestinian workers and youth and the Jewish workers and youth in within Israel, with an aim in mind, which is the overthrow of capitalism in the whole area and the establishment of a socialist federation with autonomy, with all the possible measures that can be taken in order to guarantee the achievement of national independence and national rights and self-determination of all the peoples that are part of the Middle East. It's not just Israel-Palestine, a nightmare, but if you go to Lebanon or Syria, there are The national question is extremely complex and has played an extremely reactionary role, and the only way out of it, of this nightmare, is a struggle for socialism. I'll stop there. Thanks.